morning, everybody. It's Sunday. It's Lord's Day again. Thank you for having with us today. And I greet you in the name of the Lord for this day that we are seeing each other in Facebook live stream. Thank you for everyone. Okay, so we're going to our lesson number 9, July 19, 2020. Okay, so before we begin, let's bow our head and let's pray. Father in heaven, we want to thank you for each one of us who are with us today in this live stream Bible study. May you guide each one of us as we continue, and may the peace and love to each other be upon every one of us, Lord. And thank you for your guidance every day. Thank you, Father, and guide us for the rest of our study today. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, turn your Bible in the Gospel of Mark as we continue our Bible series on the Passionate Life, Miracles and Mercy. Okay, so our lesson today is the end of the world as we know it. Okay, so turn your Bible on Mark chapter 13, verses 1 to 37. All right, so let's begin. All right, so for generations, people around the world have been speculating about the end of the world as we know it. And then maybe probably because we seem to have a general sense that our human history will eventually wind down. So, but when will it happen? So the disciples of Jesus wondered the same thing. How did Jesus reply? So according to chapter 13, verse 32, no one knows when it will arrive, which is why Jesus urged his followers to wait, watch, pray, stand alert, and be awake at all times. So this call to stay alert and wait for Jesus' return is a call to faithful following and living as God's children. So who among us would want to be caught sleeping at his return by living in a way that unworthy of the gospel we have received and believed? So the world as of today is watching and waiting for the end of the world as we know it. While we do not know when the hour will strike, we can read the signs like what we have in our present time, the COVID-19 or the coronavirus. It's now infected and damaging a lot of people and killing a lot of people around the world. And this virus is one of the signs that the end is near. So may those signs compel us to not only be alert for Jesus' second coming, but to also share readily his coming with those we know. Okay, so the background, before we go to the first point, the background of these passages of chapter 13 of the Gospel of Mark, Jesus and his disciples standing in front of the Mount of Olives. So if you see my Facebook account, I just posted last week that Jesus, you know, standing and talking about the temple that is not there anymore. So I went to Israel in 2018, and I spent 4 nights in Jerusalem, outside the old city of Jerusalem. So in those 4 nights I've been there, I experienced like a dream, and one of those 4 nights that I was in Jerusalem Gate Hotel, and but before that dream I have. I went to the front of the Western Wall, the most sacred part of the Jewish faith, that the last remaining part of the temple according to them. But in reality, Jesus mentioned that all of the standing stones and walls will be gone. It will be leveled to the ground. So Jewish people believe that Western Wall that exists now in our time is sacred to them. So I put my hand on that wall and pray to God, not to the wall, but to God, that I made two prayers that time, and And one of those two prayers was answered by God after 6 months when I come back here in Toronto in 2018. So one of the nights that I've been to Jerusalem, those four nights, I dream about, I'm looking for, you know, like in my dream, I saw myself walking in a lot of rooms, you know, checking, you know, so I don't know what it means, but I'm seeing myself that that's what I'm doing in my job presently as a nursing staff. So after 6 months, then, you know, it's an answered prayer. I got my full time in my job, and I said, you know, my prayer is like God, you know, gave me a permanent, a full time job in the city of Toronto. And then I think that is the one of the answered, you know, prayer that I asked God that day. So when I first came to Jerusalem, Mount of Olives is our first stop. So when we went there, I'll show you the booklet that I bought in Jerusalem. So this is the picture of the old city of Jerusalem if you're standing in front of the Mount of Olives. So this is what maybe Jesus saw when he was standing with his disciples in front of the temple. Okay, so you will see the Eastern Gate, which is the Golden Gate in our present time. So that is the entrance gate of Jesus when he entered Jerusalem, and people shouting that he is the Messiah. You know, Hosanna to the King, save us, Lord. So this is the Golden Gate. So if you see this, the Dome of the Rock, or the Golden Dome of the structure. So people believe that that is the location of the actual Second Temple or Herod's Temple. So this is the actual picture of the old city of Jerusalem in our present time. So this is also what I saw when I was standing in front of the Mount of Olives. So let's continue to our lesson today on point number one. Jesus described and predicted the destruction of the temple. Verses 1 to 2, chapter 13, as Jesus was going out of the temple complex, one of his disciples said to him, "Teacher, look, what massive stones, what impressive buildings." So Jesus said to him, "Do you see these great buildings? Not one stone will be left here on another that will not be thrown down." So when I was in front of the Western Wall, I can see the stones that it's been there since in the time of Jesus. And it's marvelous. It's like it's impossible to destroy, because the size of the stones is like, it's not like what we have these days. It's an ancient and an old stones, pure stones, and it's unique. So Jesus said to his disciples that, "Do you see these great buildings? Not one stone will be left here on another that will not be thrown down." So about 15 years before Jesus was born, in around 20 BC, Herod the Great began to remodel and rebuild the temple, which had stood for nearly 500 years. So since the days of Ezra, Herod made the temple one of the most beautiful buildings in Jerusalem, not to honor God, but to appease the Jews whom he ruled, just to please them, being Edomite king. Not a real Jew, but converted to Judaism, okay? And then, not to honor God. So the magnificent building project was not completely finished until 64 AD. So Jesus' prophecy that not one stone would be left on another was fulfilled in 70 AD. when the Romans, Titus as their general, the son of Vespasian, completely destroyed the temple and the entire city of Jerusalem. All right, so the second point, sign of the end of the world, okay, verses 3 to 8. Now, while Jesus was sitting on the Mount of Olives across the temple complex, so I don't know if we are standing in the same location where Jesus is standing with his disciples, but we are looking in front of the old city of Jerusalem, the temple, but the temple now, it's not there anymore. Peter, James, and John, and Andrew asked Jesus privately, "Tell us, when will these things happen? And what will be the sign when all these things are about to take place?" So the disciples of Jesus wanted to know when the temple would be destroyed. Jesus gave them a prophetic picture of that time, which included some of the events leading up to it. So Jesus also talked about future events connected with his return to earth to judge all people. So Jesus predicted both near and distant events without putting them in chronological order. So some of the disciples would live to see the destruction of Jerusalem in 70 AD. So this event would assure them that everything else Jesus predicted would also happen. So Jesus warned his followers and his disciples during that time about the future so that they could learn how to live in the present time. Many predictions Jesus made in these passages have not yet been fulfilled. So Jesus did not make them so that we would guess when they might be fulfilled, but to help us to be spiritually alert and prepared at all times as we wait for his return or his second coming. So the Mount of Olives rises above Jerusalem to the east. Okay, then from its slopes, a person can look down into the city and see the temple. When I was in the Garden of Gethsemane beside the Church of All Nations, I looked up because the Eastern Gate or the Golden Gate is on the top of the mount. So it means that the Holy City is in the top of the mount. So when you're standing in the Garden of Gethsemane, you will look high like that to see the Eastern Gate. It means that the temple is located in the high mount of Jerusalem. So it means it's high. Okay? So that's why they say, let's go up to Jerusalem. So when Jesus said that, so it means that let's go up. It means, you know, the location of Jerusalem, the old city of Jerusalem, is in a high place. Alright? So, the prophet Zechariah predicts that the Messiah will stand on this very mountain when he returns to set up his eternal kingdom. Zechariah 14:4. On that day, his feet will stand on the Mount of Olives, which faces Jerusalem on the east. So the Mount of Olives will be split in half from east to west, forming a huge valley, so that half the mountain will move to the north and half to the south. Alright? So, verses 5 to 7, then Jesus began by telling them, "Watch out that no one deceives you. Many will come in my name, saying, 'I am he,' and they will deceive many. When you hear of wars and rumors of wars, don't be alarmed. These things must take place, but the end is not yet. So what are the signs of the end times? Since Jesus' resurrection, people in every generation have claimed to know exactly when he would return. No one has been right yet, however, because Jesus will return on God's timetable, not ours. And Jesus predicted that before his return, many believers would be misled by false teachers claiming to have revelations from God. So according to the Bible or to the scriptures, one clear sign of Jesus' return will be his unmistakable appearance in the clouds, which will be seen by all people around the world. In other words, you do not have to wonder whether a certain person is the Messiah or whether these are the end times. When Jesus returns, you will know beyond a doubt, because it will be evident to everyone. Beware of groups who claim to have special knowledge about Jesus' return, because no one knows when that time will be. Be cautious about saying, "This is it," but also be bold in your total commitment to have your heart and live in life ready. For though we don't know when Jesus will return again, his return is certain, for sure. Alright? So verse 8, Jesus continued, "For nation will rise up against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be earthquakes in various places, and famines. These are the beginnings of birth pains." Natural disasters are not signs of the end time, only the beginning of birth pains or sufferings. Though troubling, these pains are signs of hope and new life. Okay, point number 3, persecutions predicted. So Jesus predicted that before the end time, there will be a great persecutions around the world, not only in Jerusalem, not only in the nation of Israel, but around the world. Verses 9 to 10, "But you," Jesus continued, "be on your guard. They will hand you over to Sanhedrins, and you will be flogged in the synagogue." So Jesus at this time referring to his disciples and his followers. "In that time, you will stand before governors and kings because of me." This is what included Apostle Paul. "As a witness to them, and the good news must be first be proclaimed to all nations." So as the early church began to grow, most of the disciples of Jesus experienced the kind of persecution Jesus was talking about. Since the time of Jesus, Christians around the world have been persecuted in their own lands and on foreign mission fields. Though you may be safe from persecution now, your vision of God's kingdom must not be limited by what happens only to you. A glance at a newspaper will reveal that many Christians in other parts of the world daily face hardships and persecutions. Persecutions are opportunities for Christians around the world to witness for Jesus to those opposed to him. God's desire is for the good news to be proclaimed to everyone in spite of persecution. So then continue on verse 11. So when they arrest you, Jesus continued, "and hand you over, don't worry beforehand what you will say. On the contrary, whatever is given to you in that hour, say it. For it isn't you speaking, but the Holy Spirit." So Jesus was teaching the kind of attitude we should have when we must take a stand for the good news. We don't have to be fearful or defensive about our faith, because the Holy Spirit will be present to give us the right words to say. And in many cases, he will have prepared the hearts of our listeners. Verse 12, "Then brother will betray brother to death," Jesus continued, "and a father his child. Children will rise up against parents and put them to death." Some Christians will experience betrayal by family members, even to the point of death, according to Matthew chapter 10, verses 34 to 36. Verse 13, And you will be hated by everyone because of my name, Jesus said. But the one who endures to the end will be delivered. To believe in Jesus and endure in the end will take perseverance, because our faith will be challenged and opposed. Severe trials will sift through Christians from fair-weather believers. Enduring to the end does not earn salvation for us, but rather marks us as already saved. So the assurance of our salvation will keep us strong in times of persecution. Point number four, the great tribulation or the great suffering. Verses 14 to 23. So in verses 14, Jesus continued, "When you see the abomination that causes desolation standing where it should not, let the reader understand. Then those in Judea must flee to the mountains." This is the Holy Land satellite map. The Judea is this area here, all right? So this is Judea, all right? This is the northern kingdom of Israel, and this is the kingdom of Judea or Judah. So this is the Judea, Judean region. Jesus said that if those in Judea must flee to the mountains, this color here, all of these are rocky mountains, you know. So there is no green mountains or trees or in the south. In the north, you will see the color green. So it means trees and grass and vegetable and everything. But in the south, this is usually desert, rocky mountains. So Jesus said these words to them to give them warnings in the future. So the background of this is the sacrilegious object that causes desecration is a reference to the destruction or the desecration of the temple by God's enemies. This happened repeatedly in Israel's history in 597 BC when King Nebuchadnezzar looted the temple and took Judean captives to Babylon. So in 169 BC before Jesus, when Antiochus Epiphanes sacrificed a pig to Zeus on the sacred temple altar. You will find this in Daniel chapter 9 verses 27 and chapter 11 chapter 30 verses 31 on the book of Daniel in 70 AD. Okay? So when the Roman general Titus placed an idol on the site of the burned temple after the destruction of Jerusalem in 70 AD, just a few years after Jesus gave this warning, in AD 38, the Emperor Gallicula or Gaius made plans to put his own statue in the temple. But he died, Gallicula died before this could be carried out. Okay, so verse 15 to 16, Jesus continued, "A man on the housetop must not come down or go in to get anything out of his house. And a man in the field must not go back to get his clothes." So what does Mark chapter 13 verses 15 to 16 mean? Jesus is prophesying about the events during the second half of the tribulation or suffering. When the Antichrist erects a statue in the temple and demands to be worshipped as a god, and Jesus and the Jews will have almost no time to flee their homes to hide in the mountains of Judea. This warning was partially fulfilled during the destruction of Jerusalem in 70 AD. When the Roman army destroyed Jerusalem and the Jews fled in the great diaspora. Houses in Israel typically included a flat roof covered in rushes where those in the house would pray, socialize, or even sleep. Maybe you remember Apostle Peter when he was in the top of the house of the Simon the Tanner in Joppa in Tel Aviv. So houses in Israel typically like this. So the rooftops were accessible through an exterior stairway. The sadness described here implies Jews or the Jewish people will not even have time to race down the stairs and duck into their homes to gather food or a staff or arad. But the prophecy cannot mean just that the 70 AD event. Jesus established that at this moment, he does not know when he will return. Even himself, as a man, only the Father knows. He does not know the timing of the end of the tribulation. Mark 13:32. So it follows that Jesus does not know the midpoint of the tribulation or suffering when the Jewish people will have to flee. This makes him concerned that it will happen in winter, when the rainy season will swell the streams and the mountains will see snow. So unlike the second coming of Jesus, there's no indication that the timing of the destruction of the temple is hidden from Jesus. In fact, the end of the siege and the fall of Jerusalem occurred in late August to early September. Jesus' prophecy has hints of 70 AD, but it will not be completely fulfilled until the tribulation or suffering. At that time, the inhabitants of Jerusalem and across Judea won't have time to gather money, ID, or identification card, or passports. They will be lucky to escape with their lives. So Jesus said, if you see that they're coming, referring to the armies of the Romans, and Titus and his army, go and flee. Don't ever come back. Just go and save yourself. Verse 17, woe to pregnant women and nursing mothers in those days. Woe is not a condemnation as in Matthew chapter 23, verses 13 to 32, but a cry of pity for pregnant women and nursing mothers unable to move quickly. You know, the pregnant women, when they're pregnant, they are having a hard time walking because of the baby in their belly. So that is what Jesus is saying here. Some Christian couples who are contemplating pregnancy have been discouraged by this verse. They wonder if children should be brought into a world filled with sin, evil, and terror. Jesus was not making a general warning against having children. However, he was saying that in the very last days, it will indeed be difficult for those with young children. But we do not know when those days will come. Many times in history of the world have had risk and drawbacks. No place or time is perfect. We must remember that God will look out for the welfare of our children as he has looked out for ours. So verses 18 and 19, Jesus continued these words to his disciples. Pray it won't happen in winter, for those will be days of tribulation, the kind that hasn't been from the beginning of the world, which God created, until now and never will be again. So winter weather, along with swollen streams that could not be crossed, would add to the difficulty of their flight according to Matthew chapter 24 verse 20 and verse also 19. So it's drawn from the book of Daniel chapter 12 verse 1. And the intensity of these days of tribulation in Revelation chapter 7 verse 14 will exceed what was experienced in the destruction of Jerusalem in 70 AD. So in verse 20, Jesus continued, unless the Lord limited those days, no one would survive. But he limited those days because of the elect whom he chose. The elect of the chosen ones are God's chosen people. We as Christians or Jewish followers, those who are saved. Okay? So we have an assurance that we don't need to worry of anything in our present time. Jesus will take care of us. Verse 21 and 22. Jesus continued, then if anyone tells you, look, here is the Messiah. Look, there. Do not believe it. For false messiahs and false prophets will rise up and will perform signs and wonders to lead astray, if possible, the elect. So be watchful and be alert. Also, for us in our time. Don't just believe, just, you know, just be prepared, because this will come. Many messianic pretenders and false prophets will come throughout the final age, all right, before the end time. Verse 23, Jesus also said, "And you must watch. I have told you everything in advance." There is a question here I want to share with you. Can Christians be deceived? Well, the answer is yes. This question, this is reminds me of Mr. James Willis Hale in 1984 to 1989 when I was in the Manila Bible Seminary in Manila, in Novaliches. I asked Mr. Hale that day if I can attend one day conference and seminar in the Philippine International Convention Center, because the missionaries who came from the States, from other denominations, are giving away free books and free literatures to all who wanted to attend the conference and seminar. So when I asked Mr. Hale, "Mr. Hale, can I go?" Because I'm working with Mr. Hale that time as the gardener, or, you know, the caretaker of his garden and outside the house. You know what Mr. Hale told me? Mr. Hale angry answered me, "Would you like to go to hell?" So that is Mr. Hale, you know, answered me. Mr. Hale knows the danger of wrong and false teachings and doctrines that leads to heresy and chaos inside the church. So Mr. Hale is a missionary to the Philippines in February 18 of 1940, and he died in December 4, 1991. So I graduated in the Manila Bible Seminary in March of 1989, and after 2 years, Mr. Hale passed away. So he dedicated his life as a missionary to the Philippines as the seminary educator for 51 years. So most of us who have been the students of Mr. Hale love him so much. And until today, I won't forget Mr. Hale and Mrs. Hale. He is one of my teachers and professors that molded me and teach me and where I am. And still, his spirit, his example is still with me up to this time. So this is what I encounter when, you know, I remember Mr. Hale is correct. Because those things happen, he knows the danger of wrong and false teachings and doctrines that leads to heresy and chaos inside the church because of the wrong teachings and doctrines of those books and literature. So Mr. Hale is correct, because when I read those books, you know what? I'm sorry to tell this, because I'm a stubborn student during that time. I didn't listen to Mr. Hale that time. I just go, you know, because I just want to see what's going on. And when I go back to the seminary, I have those maybe 2 or 3 books with me. You know what? Mr. Hale is correct, because those books, you know, it's very important to us during those times, because we need something to read. But, you know, we have to be enough with Mr. Hale's teachings and some of our professors during that time. You know, the books are so convincing and so appealing to the eyes. Good quality of books, but I remember Mr. Hale's warning to me. "Would you like to go to hell?" So, you know what? I give up those books. I don't read those books anymore. So convincing will be the arguments and proofs from deceivers in the end times that it will be difficult not to fall away from faith in Jesus. If we are prepared, Jesus says, we can remain faithful. If we are not prepared, however, we will turn away. To penetrate the disguises of false teachers, we can ask these questions. First, have their predictions come true, or do they have to revise them to fit what has already happened? Second, do any of their teachings utilize a small section of the Bible to the neglect of the whole. Third, do their teachings contradict what the Bible says about God? Fourth, are the practices they promote mean to glorify the teacher or Jesus Christ our Lord? And lastly, do their teachings promote hostility toward other Christians? So these are the questions that we have to consider here. So point number five, the coming of the Son of Man. Jesus is the Son of Man, according to Mark. Verses 24 to 25, Jesus continued his words to his disciples in front of the temple complex or facing the old city of Jerusalem. But in those days, after that tribulation, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not shed its light. The stars will be falling from the sky and the celestial powers will be shaken. So just as Jesus warned of earthly signs occurring before the tribulation or suffering, Jesus also spoke of cosmic signs occurring after that tribulation. Jesus declared that the celestial powers will be shaken as if with a heavenly earthquake. Jesus' language is drawn from Isaiah chapter 13 verses 9 to 10. Verse 26, Jesus continued again, "Then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory." Jesus drew the wording from this verse from the book of Daniel chapter 7 verse 13. Daniel the prophet said, "I continued watching in the night visions, and I saw one like a Son of Man." This is Jesus coming with the clouds of heaven. He approached the Ancient of Days and was escorted before him. So, they will see refers to those living when these events occur. The clouds are a reference to God's presence. The praise with great power and glory contrast with the Son of Man's first coming in weakness and humility. When Jesus was a baby, he was so gentle. So, the first reference to clouds in Revelation speaks of Jesus returning in the clouds in Revelation chapter 1 verse 7. Look, Apostle John said, "He is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, including those who pierce him, and all the families of the earth will mourn over him. This is certain. Amen." All right, so verse 27, Jesus said, "He will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the end of the earth to the end of the sky." The angels, or the holy spirits, or the holy angels, are regularly pictured as accompanying Christ on his return, on his second return. And point number six, the parable of the fig tree, verses 28 to 31. So verse 28, Jesus continued, "Learn this parable from the fig tree. As soon as its branch becomes tender and sprouts leaves, you know that summer is near." For Jesus' previous use of a fig tree, when the fig tree sprouts, usually in March or April around Passover, summer is near. All right? So verse 26, "In the same way, when you see these things happening, know that he is near at the door." Right? So just as Jesus' followers knew how to read the signs of the coming summer, so also when they saw these things happening, they were to know that a cataclysmic event was near. It is unclear whether Jesus was referring to Jerusalem's fall or his return in the end time. Okay, verse 30. Jesus said, "I assure you, this generation will certainly not pass away until all these things take place." "I assure you" was Jesus' standard indication of a solemn pronouncement. The generation that will not pass away until all these things takes place is either Jesus' contemporary generation, the Jewish people in that time that would live to see the destruction of Jerusalem and the temple, or the eschatological generation that will be alive when the end begins. Verse 31, Jesus said, "Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away." The truth that heaven and earth, as we know it, it will disappear, is very believable in our time, in our age of nuclear power and terrorism. Jesus tells us, however, that even though the earth will pass away, the truth of his words will never be changed or abolished. God and his word provide the only stability in our unstable world. How short-sighted people are who spend all their time and energy focused on this temporary world and its possessions and pleasures while neglecting the Bible, the Word of God, and its eternal truths. Point number 7, no one knows the day or hour, verses 32 to 37. In verse 32, Jesus continued, "Now concerning that day or hour, no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, except the Father." When Jesus said that even he did not know the time of the end, Jesus was affirming his humanity. Of course, God the Father knows the time, and Jesus and the Father are one. But when Jesus became a man, he voluntarily gave up the unlimited use of his divine attributes. The emphasis of this verse is not on Jesus' lack of knowledge, but rather on the fact that no one but God has this knowledge, and this is God the Father's secrets to be revealed when he wills. No one can predict by scriptures, by the Bible or science, the exact day of Jesus' return. Jesus is teaching that preparation, not calculation, is needed. Alright? So verses 33 to 34. Jesus said again, "Watch, be alert, for you don't know when the time is coming. It is like a man on a journey who left his house, gave authority to his slaves, gave each one his work, and commanded the doorkeeper to be alert." You know, months of planning can go into a wedding. Excuse me. The birth of a baby, or a career change, or a speaking engagement, or the purchase of a house. Excuse me. Do you place the same importance on preparing for Jesus' return, the most important event in your life? Its effects will last for eternity. We dare not postpone our preparations because we do not know when Jesus will return or will occur. The way to prepare is to study the Word of God, or the Bible, and live by it each day. By doing so, we will be ready to Jesus' return, to his second coming. Alright, so final verses. Those be alert, since you don't know when the master of the house is coming, whether in the evening or at the midnight or at the crowing or the crowing of the rooster or early in the morning. Otherwise, he might come suddenly and find you sleeping. And what I say to you, I say to everyone, be alert. All right, so Mark chapter 13 tells us how to live while we wait for Jesus' second coming, or Jesus' return. First, we are not to be misled by confusing claims or speculative interpretations of what will happen. Second, we should not be afraid to tell people whenever we are about Jesus, despite what they might say or do to us. Third, we must stand firm by faith and not be surprised by persecution. Fourth, we must be morally alert, obedient to the commands for living found in the Word of God. And this chapter was not given to promote discussions on prophetic timetables, but to stimulate right living for God in a world where He is largely ignored. So in conclusion, let's consider this. Remember Jesus, you know, Jesus preached to this world before he come back to the Father, you know. Jesus is right. We have no idea when Jesus will return. whether in the evening, at midday, at dawn, or in the middle of the night. So may we be awake at all times, waiting for Jesus' return, watching how we live, and praying that those we know will encounter the heart of God as we have. Thank you for studying with us today, and I hope I can give you something today that you can be encouraged to our faith, and let's continue serving the Lord in a different way in our lives. Our work, our job is our ministry to God. You know, we can do a lot in Jesus' name. You know, you don't need to be a preacher or teacher or evangelist or pastor or missionaries just to preach the Word of God. You can preach the Word of God through our examples, in our words, in our lifestyle. May the Lord Jesus will be upon all of us up to the end of the days, you know, up to the end of the world. Jesus will be with us forever. God bless each one of us, and may the Lord, you know, bless us and guide us now and forever. Okay. Good day, everyone. Thank you for listening. God bless.